So the next type of pollination what we are going to study is the water pollination. The second abiotic pollinating agent, it is the water. So water pollination is also known as hydrophil. It is also known as hydrophil. Okay. So water pollination. Okay. It means the pollination is taking place with the help of water. Hence, we can also call it as hydrophil. So, but this water pollination which is there, it is very rare in flowering plants. So, it is very rare in the flowering plants. But when you try to estimate, it is found to be present occurring only in about 30 genera and almost all of them are the monocots. And basically it is occurring in the aquatic plants. Okay. So here next is in the lower forms, like for example, algae, you have studied last year, bryophytes, pteridophytes. Algae, bryophytes and pteridophytes, the lower plant forms. So there you have studied that the male gametes, okay, these male gametes are usually transferred towards the female gametes for fertilization. By which medium? It is mainly by the water medium. So there also water is playing, lower form of plant groups, there also the water is playing an important role in the process of fertilization, and here also you can see water is helping in carrying out the pollination. So let us study about the two different subtypes in water pollination. The first one is epihydrophil. Epihydrophil. Epi refers to above. Hydrophil refers to water pollination. So where do you find this? We have two examples which is there in your book, NCERT book. The same examples we are taking here. One is the Vallisneria, another one is the Hydrilla. Vallisneria and Hydrilla. We are going to study about this epihydrophily with the help of Vallisneria in detail, which is important. Okay. Now, on the right side, the right side of this board, you can find there is Vallisneria plant, and you can see that there is male plant and the female plant present separately. So, Vallisneria and Hydrilla are both freshwater plants. This is you have to remember. And this Vallisneria is a dioecious plant. It is a dioecious plant. Dioecious means what? Dioecious means both male and female plants are present separately. Now, when we take this diagram, when you look into this diagram and try to concentrate, we can easily understand how the water pollination is taking place. So, as I have told you, this Vallisneria is a dioecious plant and it is completely submerged in the water, which I have shown by this water level. Okay, this is the water level, the surface level, and it is completely submerged. Main plant is there with the main flowers, and these main flowers are present in which inflorescence? The spadix inflorescence. You find the male flowers are present. Whereas the female flowers which are there, they are solitary. Solitary means what? They are single. Okay. And they are flask shaped, elongated. And you can look at the stalk. The stalk is very peculiar, very different. That is, it is having a coiled stalk. Why the stalk of this flower is coiled? Because whenever this flower has to reach the surface of the water to collect the pollen grains released from the male flower, it is pushed up. Again, after pollination, it is pulled back into the water. Okay. So, here what happens is the spadix inflorescence are having the male flowers. These male flowers get released. Okay. And they get released and they float on the surface. Once the anthers, okay, they dehisce and they release the pollen grains. These pollen grains, they, you know, immediately come near the female flower. By that time, the female flower is reaching the surface of the water. It is reaching the surface of the water, and whatever the pollen grains are released, it is immediately landing on the stigma of the female flower, and immediately after the pollination, this spirally coiled stalk is pulling back the female flower. So now, where is the pollination taking place here? On the surface of the water. Hence, we call it as what? Epihydrophilic. Okay. So these are the modifications. What you find? And once the pollination takes place at the surface of the water, I told you the female flower is being pulled back into the water. And the next process after pollination, what is it? Fertilization. Where is that fertilization taking place? It is taking place below the water. Okay, it is taking place below the water. So that is about the epihydrophilic. Moving on to the next subtype in water pollination is the hypohydrophilic. Hypo means below. Hydrophilic is water pollination. So the water pollination is taking place below the surface of the water, within the water. Okay, so we call it as hypohydrophilic. The example what you are going to study is Zostera. You are going to study with the help of Zostera. This is also known as seagrass, and it is a marine form found in the sea, marine water. Okay, so in this Zostera, what happens is the male and the female flowers are present separately, and the female flowers which are there, they are present completely submerged within the water, submerged in water, that is present inside the water. So the male flowers, they release the pollen grains. Okay, and these pollen grains have to reach down near where? Near the female flowers. Okay, so the female flowers are present submerged, the pollen grains released have to be reaching, they should reach the to the lower level as it is submerged. So these pollen grains have an adaptation, that is their shape, they are ribbon shaped. The pollen grains are ribbon shaped, elongated. Why they are ribbon shaped or why they are elongated like this, ribbon shaped structures? Mainly so that they can dive into the water and they can reach the stigma of the female flower. That's why they are ribbon shaped, or they are, you know, the thin thread like structure, so that they can easily can be carried with the help of water and they can dive into the water. Thus, it is helping in pollination. Now, where is the pollination taking place in Zostera? It is taking place below, within the water, below the water surface. Hence, we call it as hypohydrophilic. One important thing what you have to remember here is the pollen grains are ribbon shaped. Okay? I hope you have followed. Quickly moving on to the adaptations in the hydrophilous flower. Adaptations in hydrophilous flowers. So what all are the adaptations? How the adaptations or the flowers have been modified so that they can undergo the water pollination? First of all, flowers are not colorful. Even in wind pollination you have seen, flowers are not colorful. Why they are not colorful? They need not be, because it is being carried out. The pollination is being carried out with the help of an abiotic agent. So they are not colorful. They do not have no nectar. That is, the sweet sugary fluid is not secreted by these flowers. It's not required. And there is no fragrance, that sweet smell of the flowers. It is not there. So the flowers are not colorful, they do not have nectar, and there is no fragrance. Next, regarding the pollen grains. Pollen grains covered with mucilaginous sheath. mucilaginous sheath. What is this mucilaginous sheath? Mucilaginous sheath means some sticky layer. Okay, so that they are protected. Why the pollen grains of this hydrophilus flowers are sticky in nature, or they are having that mucilaginous sheath? Mainly because they are constantly present in the water and they have to be protected. Hence, they are covered with this mucilaginous sheath. And these pollen grains are ribbon shaped. You have to remember this. These pollen grains are ribbon shaped. Ribbon shaped means thin, elongated structure, so that they can easily enter into the water. They can be easily carried out with the help of the water for pollination. Okay, so this is about the adaptations in hydrophilus flowers, which is important. What is important in this hydrophily? You have to remember how the water pollination takes place in Vallisneria, how it takes place in Zostera, and the adaptations in the hydrophilus flowers. One very important thing you have to remember, you have come across two aquatic plants. That is, one is Eikornia and another is water lily. Okay, both these are aquatic plants. Now, being aquatic, the water is not helping in pollination. Okay, so why? Mainly because Eikornia and water lily, they are aquatic. They are present in water, but the flowers are present above the surface. They are emergent. Okay, they have emerged. The flowers have emerged and they are coming above the surface of the water. But then how the pollination takes place in both? So either it is with the help of air or it is with the help of the insects. Okay. So, well, this is about the water pollination. Next, moving on to the biotic agent, that is zoophily. So, moving on to the next type of agents, the pollinating agent is the biotic agents. Biotic agents, I have already told you, it means the living components are involved in pollination. So, which are those living components involved in pollination? Let us look one by one. So, here it is the, can you say, pollination is by animals. Pollination is by animals, and we call it as the zoophily. Okay, you can keep this as the third number. First one is the wind pollination. Second is the water pollination. Third is the, among biotic agents, in continuation with the previous two, third one is the pollination by animals. We call it as zoophily. Okay, so which all are the animals which are helping in pollination? Let us look one by one. It is basically, they are some bees, most of the bees, butterflies, okay, wasps, bees, butterflies, wasps, moths, different types, certain species of moths, birds, as well as the bats. Okay, so here when you look at there, these are the insects like the bees, butterflies, wasps, moths, birds, bats. All these are involved in pollination. Amongst them, okay, if you consider amongst them, in the insects, bees is supposed to be the dominating. So bees are dominant among the insects. Bees are dominant among the insects means what? Bees are helping in carrying out pollination in maximum number of plants. Okay, in most of the plants, bees are helping in pollination. Okay, so after this, there are also the larger animals which are involved in pollination. So larger animals like the primates, among primates, the lemurs, okay, are some arboreal animals. Arboreal animals means the tree dwelling animals which live on tree, like monkeys. Okay, then next is we have the rodents, different types of rodents, reptiles. Among reptiles, they have given in your textbook the garden lizard as well as the gecko lizard. Okay, and most of the snakes, some snakes are also involved in pollination. So among not only the insects, birds and bats, some larger animals are also involved in what we call as the pollination. Next is, moving on to the next part, is the entomophily. We need to understand the definition of entomophily. Entomophily means it is the pollination carried out with the help of insects. Only insects are involved in pollination. Hence, we call it as the entomophily. Please mark it important. This is important for your exam. Like the definition. Okay. So, here we have to understand, in order to undergo pollination by insects, what all are the different adaptations carried out by the flower so that they can undergo pollination only with the help of insects. Let us look into this one by one. Adaptations by entomophilous flowers. Okay, let us look the adaptations one by one. Basically, here the flowers are large. They are larger in size. Larger in size means they are bigger in size. They are colorful. The petals are colorful. Why the petals are colorful? So that they can attract the insects for pollination. They have nectar. They produce more amount of nectar so that they can easily attract the insects for pollination. So that sweet smell, when it moves out, insects basically come and they try to collect the nectar, in turn help it pollination. They also produce the fragrance. Fragrance is the sweet smell. So let me repeat this. Flowers are larger in size, they are colorful, they are having the nectar, the sweet sugary fluid, so that they can attract the insects. And they are having the fragrance. So they produce different type of, like the sweet fragrance, so that the insects get attracted and they, in turn the insects help in pollination. So in case if the flowers are small, okay, the flowers are large, I have told. But in case if the flowers are small, they are arranged in groups or cluster. What do we call it as? We call it as the inflorescence. Why? If the flowers are small, they have to be arranged in inflorescence so that they become conspicuous. Conspicuous means what? Easily visible. So that the flowers are easily visible to the insects, and the insects in turn visit them, help in pollination. Next is certain flowers. I write it here. Flowers which are, some flowers have foul odor. Foul odor means very bad smell, rottening smell, dead and decaying smell. Okay, very bad smell. So such flowers are in turn pollinated by beetles and flies. So beetles and flies, they get attracted towards this foul odor produced by the flowers, and when they visit them, they lay their eggs, or they just visit them as they get attracted because of this foul odor, and then in turn they help in pollination. So this is about the beetles and flies. they usually get attracted due to the four odd. And one more very important adaptation is the pollen grains are sticky. Okay, the pollen grains are sticky. So what happens? These pollen grains on the outer covering, there is some stickiness. So as that stickiness is there, easily they get attached to the insect's limb. Whenever the insects visit the flower, maybe it gets attracted due to the color, or it visits to collect the nectar, or it gets attracted because of the fragrance. Whenever it visits, so what happens is, as the pollen grains are sticky, as soon as the insects come in contact with the pollen grains, it gets attached to its limbs. And when this insect moves to the next flower, it helps in which process? It helps in what we call as the pollination. Okay? So, a very important character which is making the pollen grain sticky is the presence of pollen kit. Now, what is this pollen kit? See, pollen kit is an accessory coat or an extra coat present on over the surface of the pollen grain, over the exile, and it is found only in the entomophilous flowers. This pollen kit is found on the pollen grains of only the entomophilous flowers, and this is secreted by the tapetum. Where did you come across this tapetum? Yes, it is the innermost wall of the anther. Okay, so you have seen the function of tapetum. It is nutritive. Apart from being nutritive, it is helping in the secretion of this pollen kit. Where do you find this pollen kit? It is found only in the entomophilous flower, and it is providing that stickiness, that sticky nature. Okay, to the pollen grains is provided by the pollen kit. And apart from that, these pollen grains are also, having the pigments, different colors. So in turn, that is also attracting the insects. So what you have to do is, here you have to mark the adaptations of the pollen, entomophilous flowers important. And this pollen kit may be asked as one mark. Okay, for one mark as a definition it may be asked, you have to, concentrate. So you have to keep all these points in your mind. Moving on to the next part, apart from this adaptations, the floral rebar. You have some floral rewards. Rewards means gifts. Okay, someone has done some achievement and the gift is, that reward is there, some gratitude. So most of the flowers produce more number of pollens and nectar, so that it can be rewarded to the visitors. Whenever it may be the insects, it may be the birds, it may be the moth, okay, it may be larger animals. Whenever they visit the flowers and they are helping in pollination, flower in turn provides them some with rewards. What are those rewards? Those rewards are pollens and nectar. So the question may be asked, which are the floral rewards? The floral rewards may be either the pollens or it may be the nectar. Okay, so these are the floral rewards. So here what happens is, there are some certain flowers, and those flowers are amorphophallous flower. This is the largest flower, which is about 6 feet tall. Okay, and it is providing a floral reward, not by producing pollen grains or nectar. It is providing this floral reward by allowing the insects for the safe place. Okay, whenever the insects visit this flower, they find this flower to be a very safer place, so that those insects can lay their eggs. Okay, as it is very tall, the insects usually find that particular flower to be very safe, so that they can lay their eggs. So Amorphophallus flower is acting as a floral reward by giving them or providing them the safe place. Okay. Next, after this, you have one more example which I will be writing here. It is the moth. Few species of moth and few species of this yucca flower. They are completely interdependent on each other. How is that? Let us see. So this moth basically visits the yucca flower. Why does it visit the yucca flower? So that it is laying the eggs. It lays the eggs there. In turn, by laying the eggs, it is helping in pollination. It is helping this yucca plant to undergo pollination. So moth is basically visiting this yucca flower because it is finding a safe place and it is laying the eggs. But where is it laying the eggs? It is laying the eggs within the locules of the ovary. It is laying the locules. Locules are what? Locules are the chambers. Okay. But in turn, what it is doing? It is helping in pollination. So moth is getting the benefit from the yucca flower because it is getting the place to lay the eggs. In turn, yucca is getting the benefit from the moth because this moth is in turn helping in carrying out the pollination. So both are interdependent on each other. Without one of the organism, if moth is not there, yucca cannot complete its life cycle. If yucca plant is not there, then moth cannot complete its life cycle. Okay. So what happens is, as the pollination has already taken place and the insect has laid the eggs within the locules of the ovary, after few days the larvae comes out of this, you know, eggs, whatever it has laid. Okay. Simultaneously, due to this pollination already which has taken place, fertilization takes place, and simultaneously seeds also start developing. That is, the eggs hatch into the larvae and the ovules are converted into the seed simultaneously. This is how the moth and yucca are interdependent on each other. Okay. Moving on to the last part, that is the pollen drops. Pollen droppers, you can also name them as, call them as the nectar robbers. Robbers means thief. Okay, so here what happens is, in this pollen robber or the nectar robber, there are some insects as well as birds which visit the plants, which visit the flowers. They collect the nectar, they collect the pollen grains, but they are not helping in pollination. They are eating that, they are consuming that nectar, they are eating up those pollen grains, but they are not helping in pollination. Hence we call such birds or insects as pollen robbers or the nectar robbers. Let us look at some examples of these. These are the sunbirds and few wasps. And there are many more examples. Now you just remember, these sunbirds and wasps can be called as the pollen robbers or nectar robbers. Now please mark, this is also important. This is very important. Okay, so what all are important now in this biotic agent? The definition of entomophily, definition of pollen kit, floral rewards, pollen droppers, the association of both, interaction of both moth and yucca, and adaptations in entomophilous flowers. So with this, I complete the agents of pollination. Thank you.